Edge just declared Morrison Formation Week, and just like with Mosasaur Week, we're encouraged to post anything related to it. The Morrison Formation refers to a distinct sequence of sedimentary rock from the western United States. It includes many popular dinosaurs from the Upper Jurassic, and it's probably most famous for being the nexus of the deplorable bone wars between Othniel Charles Marsh and Edward Drinker Cope. So today I want to share with you representatives from my favorite dinosaur group, the Sauropods. Now, unlike most of my reviews, I won't be talking about scientific accuracy, and mainly why each one is special to me. The Sauropods are some of the most iconic dinosaurs. Now, every child has had a Brontosaurus, Diplodocus, or even a Brachiosaurus. And if you ask anyone to draw a dinosaur, even at the crudest level, this is what you might get. Now don't worry, this isn't a cheap plug to sell you my masterclass on paleo art. So when we talk about the Morrison Formation itself, let me go retro a bit and revisit how it started for me. The Carnegie collection of Apatosaurus and its baby. I was first introduced to these wonderful models in 1994 when a dinosaur exhibit came to town. One of the first exhibits with life-size animatronic dinosaurs. At the end of it was a pop-up souvenir store. And what should I see for the very first time? But this. There was something about the display that told me instinctively that these were not your usual dinosaur toys. I didn't have much savings, so I just bought these two. But I kept thinking about those other sauropods I left on the shelf, and finally, I had to go back. I was worried I had to buy tickets all over again, and I learned that nope, for these kinds of exhibitions, you can go straight to the souvenir shop and just spend your money. So I got these. Now, I skipped a few meals here and there during that time, but man, it was worth it. Now, the first thing that strikes me is the size of them. The sheer bulk is really worthy of the word sauropod. To give you an idea, here's something more recent for comparison. The PNSO Wilson, the T-Rex. Each Carnegie collection dinosaur had an information tag stating 1 to 40th scale. And that's when I fell in love with the idea of having everything in that scale to show relative sizes. Of course, I now know that declared scales are never to be fully believed, but it got me started. First, the diplodocids, specifically a diplodocine. And here, Diplodocus will represent. Now look at this Carnegie original. The very length of it. It's always nice to have something long and impressive, and what a visual impact this made, sitting on the table, occupying the space it deserved. The dinosaur just seems to go on and on, and on, and on. And even in this early reconstruction, you see that whip-like tail. I love this really retro upright neck here. The hip hump. And the huge legs, just look at these toes. Updating this, first we have Carnegie's own 2006. Now you can see it's a less blocky animal with more slenderness in the torso and legs. The paint application is nice and you see the beginnings of more modern, visually interesting coloration. Oh, look at the way the edges of the patina handled. And when I look at this, it makes me a little sad when I see so many models today with excellent sculpts ruined by really lackadaisical and crude paint applications. And yet way back in 2006, we could have something like this. Then we have the very beautifully sculpted 2017 Safari Limited Diplodocus, with even nicer anatomy. you see the neck posture, the more gracile nature of the limbs, and most of all, these spinal scutes running down the length of the animal, an idea I was first exposed to by the Walking with Dinosaurs series. Now we get to see the kind of finer detail more the norm in today's dinosaur replicas. Now I like the very subdued color and pattern, and even though paint application itself was, shall I say, schematic compared to the 2006 and could really have used more washes, I love the overall impression of this model. Now moving on to the apatosaurines, here's the original 1988 Carnegie and the only apatosaurus I have. You can see that this is one big solid mother. There's something about it that just feels so impressive, despite the simple color and texture, and of course, the inaccuracies. Now there's something about retro dinosaurs that makes me smile. I mean, look at these massive feet and the toes again. Again, in the hump, so often seen in cryptid sketches. And even the aircon hose texture of the neck. With the addition of a baby, which elevates the scene, this was also my very first exposure to a diorama. I love the contrast between what's obviously a massive heavy with the display of tenderness between mother and child. Now here's the only Brontosaurus I have, the 2018 Collectae. Now Collectae really does some nice sauropods, but they all suffer from one major flaw, in my opinion, their small size. Now just look at the texturing on this one. You see the different profile and posture? And that detail, the scales and the scutes. Again here, the spinal osteoderms that seem to be a favorite in reconstructions of apatosaurine dinosaurs. Here, artistic license gives us something interesting, with the single row ending here. And two parallel rows starting here, only to converge into a single row again near the end. And also the more varied coloration, with this very faint striping down the animal that you can barely make out. As well as the effort to include some washes here on the underside. And to round out my Carnegies, my very first Macronarian, and still my favorite Carnegie sauropod, the Brachiosaurus, this bruiser. Now, two things stood out for me. One, the height of it, 35 centimeters or 13.8 inches, that's almost 14 inches tall. And second, the heft of it, 1.2 kilograms or about 2.7 pounds. Now with those stats, it was easy for me to believe the estimated weight on the information tag. Now this was way back before more realistic size estimates, and it's been 27 years, but I believe it said 70 tons, or it could be 75 tons. Again, look at those retro texturing. The ridiculous size of the hands and feet, but still very lovable. Finally, let me finish off with the most common sauropod from the Morrison Formation, Camarasaurus. And we have two entries. The first is the Carnegie Collection Zone 2001. And already, despite the inaccuracy most obvious in the hand, you can already see Carnegie taking on a more accurate reconstruction of anatomy, also in 1 to 40th scale, which I love. The skin texturing is already more modernized, as is the pattern, this time very similar to a cow. And even though he's generally all grey, you can also see the effort made to blend in the edges of the patterning. We also have perhaps my favourite recent sauropod, delightfully also in 1-40th scale, the Safari Limited 2019 Camarasaurus. Now this has all the features I liked about the Carnegie, but it fixes the feet. The position of the nostrils, and also a more natural, less sinister look to the toothy grimace of the Carnegie. It's slightly shorter, and yet appears to have more volume. And except for those little discrepancies, these two display very well together. Perhaps a sexually dimorphic couple. So, here are my original trio from Carnegie. Now, building around that, we have my later and more modern models. And looking at all of this in totality, one thing jumps out at me. While these newer models become more pleasing with an increasing emphasis on accurate anatomy, they are generally small. Now I get that, because really to have sauropods of this size, it's really quite hard to sell them, especially now when the international markets have become more important. That means companies need to keep the shipping down. At this scale, they're smaller, with less sculpted detail needed, and more people can have them. So while I understand it, it's with a pang of regret, because what awed me as a child and as an adult about the sauropods and why they're indeed my favorite group is the sheer awesomeness of the mega sizes. That's something that only very large physical manifestations can even hint at. I only hope that PNSO brings back its hollow, large, vinyl dinosaurs, like this. So that's our look at some Morrison Formation sauropods, and an excuse for me to bring out and touch base again with some of my favorite, most nostalgic pieces. Now, which one of these did you have as a child? What dinosaur got you started? And what's your favorite dinosaur from the Morrison Formation? Let me know in the comments below. And do think about creating some related content before the 31st of May, and use the hashtags I'll include in the description box below. I'll see you guys soon.